Maybe they're going to say that there was a rogue element, you know, in the hijack exercise, and instead of landing the planes, they took them into the Pentagon. I don't know. But you can see, you get the shape of it. And those guys in Congress, if they're serious about this, they've got a lot of staffers. I mean, I've just done this pretty much single-handedly. They've got a lot of staffers. If you gave me, you know, if you gave me and Cynthia McKinney 10 good staffers, we'd tidy this up. You know, this isn't like Kennedy, where, you know, there's not enough evidence. You never can be quite sure what happens. This is a very easy case to solve. If we could get the powers needed, the grand jury powers, the subpoena powers, it wouldn't be difficult.
Okay. I'm going to thank you very much, Ian Henshall, for your thoughts here. We're going to shift back over now for Professor Stephen Jones to give his closing thoughts, and then I'll come back to you, Ian, for any closing thoughts from you on today's program. Dr. Jones, you were talking about a member of the Japanese parliament,
right,
and how the Washington Post has attacked that individual for his
right
statements. Please fill us in on that.
Yeah, thank you, Gary. And it's just what Ian was talking about, this smear job that is used so typically in the media as they try to prop up this failing official story of 9/11. So there's a report, an editorial yesterday, March 8th, in the Washington Post, which is an attack, a direct attack on an influential member of the upper house of Japan's parliament, to which he was elected in 2007. This is Yuki Fujita. And instead of considering in a respectful manner his questions, Fujita's questions about 9/11, they say that they won't give it any serious discussion, and they use terms such as embarrassment and bizarre and half-baked and bogus, you know, without giving any reason for that. They do mention that Fujita questions the official explanation for the collapse of Building 7, World Trade Center 7. They mention some of these views, but without giving any serious discussion, they attack Fujita personally. And I think it's just so characteristic. I really hope this backfires on them to attack a respected member of the Japanese parliament. This is an ally of ours. And, of course, he is calling for an investigation, Fujita. He's calling for an international investigation, which I think is his right and responsibility. There were 24 Japanese citizens who died in the collapse of the World Trade Center towers on 9/11, and he has every right to demand answers to his questions then. And an international investigation sounds like just the right thing. I really think the water is getting hot to have an ally of the United States, a respected member of the Japanese parliament, upper house, demanding an international investigation. This is going to get some traction, I think, and their attack on him personally, I believe, will totally backfire. I'll tell you, the 9/11 truth community, as we're called, is worldwide. And we are not going to stand for this type of ad hominem and personal attacks on a respected member of the Japanese parliament who is making a very reasonable request for a thorough investigation as to what happened and why 24 citizens of his country died on that day. For him to be mistreated with such a lack of tact in the Washington Post shows their desperation, in my opinion, and I believe this move on the part of the Washington media will backfire and will result in increased attention as to what really happened on 9/11. And I hope the international investigation that Mr. Fujita seeks will come to pass.
Okay, I thank you. Stay on the line one moment. I'm going to go back to Ian Henshall. But before I go back to you, Ian, there are those who would say, well, this is without precedent, that there would be an effort at a coup d'etat. Yes, we're familiar with coups in other countries. Pakistan has had multiple coups. But but I would refer people to the official record. General Smedley Butler, November 24, 1934. Butler was one of the most respected military personnel in American history, and he came forward and he asked for a congressional investigation, which was done. In fact, you can look at this specific record. It is the title of this report was November 21st, 1934, number 273. Special Committee on Un-American Activities, House of Representatives, 73rd Congress, Second Session, Representative John W. McCormick and Representative Samuel Dickstein, and it was released in New York City, November 24, 1934, and it's in the Library of the University of California. Now, basically what he says was, and this was the title of the report, A Study of Fascist Plot, and it was naming Wall Street bigwigs to engage in a march, and it was supposed to be what was called the Treason March. And a Gerald McGuire was one of the people from New York who was the backer of this, but also the backers included the heads of DuPont, U.S. Steel, Chase Manhattan, Goodyear, Prescott Bush, who was President Bush's grandfather, and the man who was supposed to lead this march that they had given thousands, tens of thousands of dollars to lead this march was General Smedley. And Smedley, Butler, decided that he would not be a part of an ability to take over the United States. Mind you, this is in the middle of the Great Depression. We're talking about 1934, prior to World War II, where we had many Americans, including Henry Ford and Charles Lindbergh, who were very sympathetic to what Hitler was doing in Germany at that point. And these people believed that the progressive movement of Franklin Delano Roosevelt was wrong. They believed that America was on the wrong path. It was on a path toward socialism. And Roosevelt was applying some laws and standards to the business community and to the banking community they were not happy with. So they conspired to meet together, and their point person was Gerald McGuire. He's the one who met with Smedley Butler and said, "Butler, you're the most respected military man in the United States at that time," which he was, mind you. This is before General MacArthur in the Second World War, Eisenhower in the Second World War. He was the man. And they gave him a lot of money, and they said they wanted to take over the United States government and bring it back to what it should be. And he then went to members of Congress, and they held testimony. They brought in these people who were supposed to be in the conspirators. It was all done in executive session. So nobody knew what was said in executive session because these are secret testimonies. And after that, it was never looked into by the American media again. So if someone says we do not have a history of attempted coup d'etat, planned coup d'etat in the United States, then they are grossly ignorant of American history. Now, I've given you congressional hearing, the date, the title, the people who were conducting it, and yet ask anyone in Congress today, are you familiar with the statements by America's most famous general, a military hero, a patriotic American, someone who was so famous that the conspirators wanted him to lead this march on Washington, and then the march would end up in throwing the President of the United States out of office and substituting other people. And Smedley Butler talked about who would replace President Roosevelt and how everything would be run after that. No one has talked about any of this, as if this never happened. Well, it did happen. And I'm suggesting, until such time that we have all the different questions answered correctly and honestly, then what we have been told is the official position on 9/11 is simply self-serving propaganda. And I'm ashamed at the American media, including the Washington Post and the New York Times and others, for not having their own investigative reporters decide to do what you've done, Ian, as an investigative journalist, and look for the truth. and not take a position that somehow couldn't be the truth because it involves people that we may like or be a part of our political party, instead of looking at an issue ideologically.